turn it over to Sabrina to give us a report on what she's heard.
Thank you, Joe. Hello, everyone. My name is Sabrina Brewer, and I'm currently a student here in Colorado Springs at Colorado College. I want to begin just by thanking everyone who spoke today, and I know I'm going to be repeating a lot of what everyone said, but I wanted to acknowledge all the important contributions that each panelist has made. Immediately in the opening of the summit, and this could be because I'm a history major and I love storytelling, but I just noticed that the Mississippi River is a story of embodiment of the changes in the area and the people who have and continue to live along its banks and the various networks that depend on this river for life. And it's a deeply personal story. We heard the numerous personal stories that each panelist shared about their childhoods and their experiences. And I think this just goes to show that the freshwaters are a network of life that connects each one of us and it takes care of us. But unfortunately, as we heard in the first session and throughout the rest of the day, we have not taken this life seriously or respected it. There's been overdevelopment, damming, droughts, and a lack of understanding for the river's need to run. And all of these factors have seriously damaged the river's health. Kim Lutz and Olivia Dorothy shared a very troubling report on the risk to public safety and biodiversity. There's been an increase in water surges, a decrease in water quality, excessive agricultural and urban development, and a loss of natural habitat that all threaten the health of the Mississippi River and the people and animals who depend on this river for life. And when we're thinking about these issues and how we can address them, another common thread that I notice is the numerous and diverse stakeholders that are involved. We can't address this issue from an isolated position or thinking from a singular perspective. This is going to take personal, local, state, national, global community conversations and approaches. Farmers are going to need better incentives for better environmental practices. We need more collective approaches to data collection. Floodplain restoration and nature-based approaches to restoration all need better funding. And we need to find more accessible ways to engage the public so that each person understands the stake that they have in the river. So overall, this needs to be a people-driven response. It needs to be an intentional community approach that values the communication amongst stakeholders. And when we think about this, we also need to ask ourselves a number of questions. What are the conflicting interests amongst stakeholders and how are these addressed on local, state, and national levels? Whose voice is carrying the most weight in terms of policy decisions? How can we respond to the racial and economic disparities that appear along the Mississippi and throughout the US? And we need to find creative solutions to these issues because they are complex and interconnected problems. But as we have also seen from the video from Sandra Postel, our personal choices can make a difference, whether that's along the Mississippi or elsewhere in the world. They are real adoptable solutions. And from John and Holly, we've seen how citizen science and monitoring systems can fill these data gaps by focusing on organic localized strategies that center decentralized, it's funny, center decentralized, autonomous approaches. And our communities need transparency and empowering methods for monitoring environmental changes and issues. And as Mary continued our conversation with the story of the STREAM team, I found this to be a very moving story in terms of that's individuals who noticed a problem in their community and they decided to do something about it. And that's where it started. But from there, it grew into a large network and the impact was more widespread as a result. So those numerous partnerships are required to address the number of issues involved in a river's health. And Dr. Sharon Dean further reinforced this through talking to us about the movement of One Health. The problems that we face and the solutions that we envision are all interconnected. So again, addressing this can't be an isolated approach. It takes us all recognizing that the rivers and freshwater biomes are shared environments and that we each have a role in protecting them. And Susie, she further reinforced this in terms of our intimacy to our connection to nature and the need to relearn and rediscover how to listen to our environments. Trees, the rivers, water, all of our environments, they have something to teach us. But unfortunately, we have continued to close ourselves off to hearing. But I think today there was hope and optimism that when we do activate our listening and we do let nature be our guide, that there can be substantial changes along the way. And a final closing point, I think another theme today is that it can be difficult for us to change our ways and our habits when that's what we're used to, despite all the evidence that is showing us that we must change. So something I've been asking myself is, how do we change our ways? How do we learn to care and help others care? And I'm not sure if I have a singular answer to that problem, but after listening to everyone today, I'm taking away that maybe part of the answer requires turning inward and finding the significance that nature holds for us on a personal level and recognizing the ways in which we're all interconnected. We each have a story with nature, whether that's looking out your office window at a park across the street or thinking about the creek you played in as a child. If we can reflect back on that, I think there's substantial changes that can occur. So I might be leaving with a few more questions than answers, but I know that that's part of the process of change and fueling that change. And so again, I want to thank all the panelists for sharing their expertise and knowledge, and thank y'all for listening to me retell everything that was covered. But I look forward to continue engaging and listening to the stories and visions that will be shared with us in the coming days. So thank you.
Oh my. Sabrina, thank you so much. Such a good job, I have to say. Joseph, I want to invite you in. Just come step right in and give us your final reflections before I send everyone off. The audience has been incredible. I'd love for you to come in and just be able to close it out for yourself personally, your experience today. You did a brilliant job. And Sabrina, go ahead and turn your camera on. Joe may want to say something to you.
All right. I do. Thank you, Myra. My gosh, Sabrina, that was incredible. I think that was as ideal a summary of today's discussion as we could hope to have, insightful and capturing a lot of the different threads. And I think it's good that there are questions. I think that's because if there weren't, we wouldn't be getting started solving something, right? So thank you, Sabrina, for giving us just an excellent report on the good work these people are doing. I'm not going to try to match that, but I would like to say a few words. I don't want to repeat everything I've said before, but I do think that we are at a moment when it is possible to see that the way that we create value as a society has to change, has to evolve, has to get richer. New kinds of knowledge have to be a part of how we understand what value is and how we measure it. And I think those of us who are part of this day and this week know that. But I just want to highlight that I think that ran through everything we heard today. And now I want to echo a little bit of where we started today. And I also want to give the closing words to someone else who's not with us at the moment. A great spiritual leader of the Lakota, Dakota, Nakota, Oyate, Chief Arvo Looking Horse, said this in a way I think it should be said. I'm not gonna claim his words as my own. I do wanna honor his prayerful relationship to water and nature. He said some of what I'm gonna say now in February of 2018. And I think his words helped to ground why we're all here. To think about the health of fresh waters, our collective health, and also the health and viability of our way of being. He said that his life's work has been to bring attention to water and to unite all nations, all faiths in one prayer. He spoke about supporting the establishment of a World Peace and Prayer Day, a UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, and the Nazul Declaration about essentially a new way of coming together to achieve a sustainable world. rooted in traditional knowledge and reciprocity. And he said that in his tradition, we pray for everything we eat and drink so our minds can be good. Because when the things we do don't work with nature, our minds are not good. And so he added, in the sacred hoop of life, there is no ending and no beginning. And finished with words that I think should be the words we close with, heked onipikte, that we shall live.
Well, thank you, Joe. Thank you, Sabrina. Thank you, audience.